haciendo para completar el pico. Un poco mierda, ¿no?
Perfecto. Shall we start?
Yeah.
Okay, so thanks for coming to this second week of activities for the AI Initiative for Science event. Today we are going to have Pablo, which is talking to us about the machine learning in galactic cosmologies and cosmological scale. So, yeah.
Thanks, Pablo. Thank you, Brian. Thank you to the organizing committee and also to all for coming. So I'm going to talk a little bit about different machine learning methods and how they can be applied to cosmology at galactic and cosmological scales. So no.
No?
Sí. Okay. So as you know, during these last decades, we have improved our understanding of the real universe thanks to the consolidation of the lambda CDM model, which is just the standard paradigm in modern cosmology. But however, there are still some open problems in cosmology. So for instance, this is the case of dark matter and dark energy. So we know that these sources of energy have to contribute to the energy content of the universe, but we still ignore about their specific nature and components, for instance. So as another example, there are many uncertainties regarding how the cosmological structures has grown from the initial perturbations seeded by inflation. And related with this fact, we also ignore how first galaxies and first stars were formed during the evolution of the universe, and also the role of astrophysical effects, baryonic physics, in this process. So how active galactic nuclei or supernova can affect the supernatural medium and modify the formation of structures. And also the well-known Hubble tension, which is just the disagreement between late and early time measurements of the expansion rate of the universe. So in this context, machine learning approach can provide us with a new perspective in order to tackle this kind of problems in a data-driven approach. So let me illustrate some of these possible advantages of using machine learning, specifically neural networks. So for instance, we can, with a neural network, we can infer information directly from data without relying on any summary statistics. So for instance, in the traditional approach in cosmology, so we have a data set, for instance, the map or the temperature map in the cosmic microwave background, the CMB, or a density field from an body simulation. And then in order to extract the underlying cosmological information, which are the cosmological parameters, we have to compute some summary statistics, such as the angular power spectrum for the CMB, or the 3D matter power spectrum for the body simulation, or maybe other higher endpoint correlation functions. So this approach, however, assumes that we need one of these summary statistics, and sometimes it is not clear which of these statistics will be more appropriate for the problem and which of them will maximize the information that we can extract. In contrast, a neural network can directly learn information from the data, extract patterns, and extract the more relevant features from the data itself in order to extract the underlying cosmological parameters. And this has been proven to be very, very powerful. For instance, in these works, where this is done for the CMB case and for embodied simulations, using residual networks and convolutional neural networks. And for instance, in the embodied case, this represents a big improvement over using only the matter power spectrum, for instance. So as another example, you know that in cosmology, we only can access to some even observables, for instance, a galaxy survey. But what we actually want to know is the underlying dark matter density field, which is producing the overdensities, the potential worlds where the galaxies are placed. So it will be useful to have a way to connect these two different cosmological maps. So for instance, in this work, the authors use convolutional neural networks to predict from a given embodied simulation of the density field of the dark matter to predict the corresponding field of galaxies as predicted from a hydrodynamic simulation. So doing that, we can gain a better understanding of how galaxies and dark matter are related and, well, understand the galaxy dark matter connection. And as a...
Sorry, what do they use to predict the galaxy? They have the typical model of if the halo is large enough, I have a galaxy?
So they have hydrodynamic simulations for producing the map of galaxies. And on the other hand, they have embodied simulations, which are like much more easy to employ and much faster. So the point is that they compute the link between both pieces. No, so with the same initial conditions, they run an embodied simulation and a hydrodynamic simulation. This is accurate simulation, which is expected to represent well the universe and the galaxies that we observe.
Okay, so they include the baryons?
Sure, sure. All the baryonic physics and astrophysical feedback is included here, which is the key point in all these things. And actually, this leads us to the next point, which is actually marginalized over astrophysics. So when we have cosmological observations, there are many uncertainties regarding how astrophysics can alter the observations that we are seeing. For instance, if we have a supernova, the supernova can release energy and matter to the surrounding medium and alter the different structures that there are formed. So in order to extract meaningful information, meaningful cosmological information from a set of observations, for instance, it is required to have a way to marginalize over these astrophysical uncertainties. And this can be performed using, for instance, convolutional neural networks, as is shown in this work, where these people from a given set of hydrodynamic simulations covering a broad range of astrophysical models, they extract the underlying cosmological parameters, removing in some way the astrophysical uncertainties in order to extract these fundamental quantities, which are in this case, the omega matter and sigma 8, which are the fundamental quantities in cosmology. So in order to illustrate these advantages, I'm going to focus on this talk on two different projects where these three points are in some way exemplified. For instance, namely the inference directed from data, marginalization of astrophysics, and connecting different cosmological maps. So on the one hand, I'm going to talk about this first project where we extract the matter density field from 21 centimeter maps using convolutional neural networks. And on the other hand, I'm also going to talk about how we can infer the mass of a dark matter halo using properties of its hosted galaxies. And this is based on a relatively novel method based on graph neural networks. So let me start with this first project, which is based on this publication that I made with Paco y Escusa. And after this was published this year. So let me briefly review the basics of this 21 centimeter physics. So the point is that this is an atomic transition which arises from the hyperfin structure in the hydrogen. So you have the spin of the electron and spin of the proton get coupled and split the ground energy state into two energy levels, which are separated by a wavelength of 21 centimeters. So since the intergalactic medium, which is the medium between galaxies, is filled by hydrogen atoms, so we can expect a significant intensity from this atomic transition. The point is that a 21 centimeter photon, which is emitted at a high resist, so at an early epoch, will be resisted and therefore a frequency decreases. So what we are actually observing is a spectrum of different frequencies, where each of these frequencies is providing us information about the epoch when this was emitted or absorbed if we are looking at the absorption profile. So we can therefore trace the evolution of the universe thanks to this thing. So it is customary to write the intensity of the variance of the 21 centimeter intensity as the differential variance temperature, which is just relative to the CMB. And we can see that it depends on several quantities, for instance, the fraction of neutral hydrogen atoms, the matter over density, and the spin temperature, which is basically given by the thermal temperature of the gas. So there are future interferometers, such as SKA, which could be able to measure 21 centimeter maps. Thanks to this resist information, it could provide a tomographic view of the universe and produce 3D maps of the universe, of the intergalactic medium, actually. So since this brightness temperature is tracing matter over density, so this quantity here, this matter over density is a fundamental quantity because it is telling us how matter is distributed and is clustered in the intergalactic medium. And therefore, it contains meaningful information about dark matter, for instance, or maybe initial perturbation from inflation. So it will be very useful to extract this information from a given brightness temperature map. The point is that this quantity depends on the fraction of the hydrogen and the spin temperature, which strongly rely on the astrophysical processes. So to illustrate that, we can see here maps of the brightness temperature at different resets, so different epochs, with their corresponding matter over density fields. So we can see that there is a connection between them, but at low resets, around the over densities where the galaxies are placed, these galaxies start to emit a lot of energetic radiation, which starts to ionize and heat the medium. And therefore, the link between these two maps weakens in some way.
Well, there's one curiosity.
Sure.
Here is just my ignorance. How do you extract the question? The real data? Or this is just simulation?
So this is for simulations.
Okay.
In reality, when you have a spectrum of frequencies.
Yeah, yeah.
So this transition are happening at 21 centimeters, at a wavelength of 21 centimeters. But if you have a photon which is coming towards us, so it is received because of the expansion of the universe.
Okay.
So the frequency is telling you where when these photons were emitted or absorbed.
Perfect.
Pablo, then is really training through simulation to simulation?
In this case, yes, we are training only in simulations. But the point of this project is to, in the future, eventually apply to real data, because this is the final goal.
True.
So,
sorry, the data set is set of pictures?
Set of pictures, yes. I want to talk about that
later.
So, actually, here. So we, therefore, for doing this task, we perform 1,000 simulations of this brightness temperature with this corresponding matter density field. So these are 2D maps. And so these are carried out with the 21 centimeter fast code, which is some sort of semi-analytic approach to compute these things. But for the resets and scales that we are interested in, so this is enough for us. And it is much faster than a full accurate hydrodynamic simulation. So the point is that for each of these 1,000 simulations, we vary the different astrophysical parameters, which are expected to be the more relevant ones to affect the brightness temperature map. So these are the X-ray luminosity, which is basically ruling the efficiency of the heating of the gas. The a minimum mass to host star formation, which is setting the amount of galaxies which are contributing to release energetic radiation. And also the number of ionizing photons per body, which is even the efficiency of ionization. So in this way, we train a neural network. In this simulation, varying these astrophysical parameters, we could marginalize over this astrophysical information. And since we are dealing with 2D maps, so the appropriate tool for that are convolutional neural networks. So just to remind you how this architecture works. So imagine that we have an input image. So we can filter each of the pixels of this image with different kernels. And each of these kernels are extracting detecting some pattern in the image and extracting the so-called feature map or convolution map. And each of them are trained in order to maximize the patterns that we are extracting from it, to maximize this information. So after performing these convolutions, we then can downsample these layers by applying a pooling layer, which is just reducing the dimensionality of our layers, but retaining the more relevant information which is extracted from these kernels, from these convolutions. So we can perform these steps as many times as we want. And finally, for instance, in an image classification problem, we can append a fully connected layer, a multi-layer perceptron, to extract the label of the image, for instance, in this case. So for our problem, so we have a different framework because we want to go from an input 2D map to an output 2D map. And therefore, we have to rely on a bit different architecture, which is the so-called unit, which is on here. So just to briefly explain it, this is composed by an encoder part, where there are some applications of these convolutional layers and pooling layers in order to downsample the input image. So this is extracting different feature maps to extract different patterns from the image, until they find a latent space where all the possible information from this image is stored. And from it, there is a decoder branch where this latent space is upsampled due to transpose convolutions in order to produce an output which has the same dimensions on the data. So here the key idea is that there are these skip connections which are taking some of the layers from the encoder and then concatenated to the decoder. And this way we are retaining some of the original information from this first part, and not only relying on the latent space. So maybe you have heard about autoencoders. So machine learning autoencoder is very similar to this, but without this skip connection.
Basically. But so I mean the typical example when you start studying these autoencoders is that the output image should be like the same image as
yes.
As the input.
Mm-hmm. This is for an autoencoder.
In your problem, this is different, right? So you are
I'm connecting two different maps.
So you're connecting two different maps.
Exactly. Yes, but you can use this same
architecture. Sure.
The point is that these skip connections are retaining some information which is very relevant for doing that. And actually, an autoencoder fails in doing that because of that, because it lacks these residual connections. So, well, we have trained this unit in this controlled simulation, but in astrophysical parameters. And these are examples of the results. So, we input a brightness temperature map, 21 centimeter map, to predict the underlying density field. And in this example, this is the prediction of the network, which at a glance we can see that it resembles pretty accurately the true matter density field. So note here that we are not providing to the network information about astrophysics. So this is something that the unit is learning from the data set. So it is actually marginalizing over all the astrophysical effects to extract these maps, which are independent of the astrophysical parameters. So this is only cosmology without without the astrophysical context. So in order to have a better quantitative view of the accuracy of this network, so we can compute the so-called power spectrum, which is just the Fourier transform of the two-point correlation function. And also, this is like the most basic tool in cosmology to analyze this kind of data. And also two other related functions, which are the transfer function and the cross-correlation coefficient, which are given by the ratio between the predicted power spectra and the true power spectra. And in this case, it is crossing the Fourier modes. And these quantities are given as information about the amplitudes and the phases of the Fourier modes, how they are being recovered. So if the transfer function or the cross-correlation function are close to one, it means that the accuracy is good. And here we can see that actually we have like 5% relative error down to scales inverse to the megabars. So that here, this k is the wave number, which is roughly the inverse of the moving scale, because we are working in Fourier space. So this is telling us that the neural network is actually very accurate down to very small scales. And also it is properly learning how to sample the amplitudes and the phases of the Fourier space. So.
In the one before, you are talking about your predictions where you are marginalizing over astrophysical parameters.
Yes.
So I guess the philosophy is then that you want to, this mapping between the 21 and the density of the matter has to be robust even within variations of the astrophysical.
Yeah, that's the point.
And that you managed to do this. But I was wondering if this is, like, would you expect this to be the case? Would you expect that this mapping is more or less independent of these astrophysical parameters? Or on the contrary, you would say that the mapping is influenced and you could use it actually to obtain better predictions for the astrophysical parameters?
Well, the point is that the matter density field, in principle, should be independent on the astrophysical effects, at least for these scales, because we are not including some astrophysical feedback effects which could affect the star matter density. But in this case, this should be independent. For this reason, this marginalization should provide the proper density field.
And the fact that you expect this to be independent, is that in all the scales, or the fact that you get better determination in the center, let's say, is related to that?
So the point is that it is not clear if there is if you can completely extract this density field from a given 21 centimeter map. because these astrophysical effects are mostly happening or affecting the smallest scales.
Yes.
So for the reason, and here we are only using information from a given rest. So maybe we use information from several rests at once. It will include further correlations, and it will be easier. But in principle, it is not clear if there is a correlation one-to-one between range temperature and density map. So this is not a trivial task.
Okay. Yes.
And so I was saying this is for RESIC 15, but if we train a neural network using only maps at RESIC 10, so we see that here the result gets worse at the smallest scales. And this is just because I was telling that here the effects of astrophysical effects, so ionization and heating of the medium, are stronger here and are affecting more the smaller scales. And we can see the link between these two maps. So yeah, we can see that there is a worse accuracy at the smaller scales, but still the larger scales are still well recovered. So in this way, these astrophysical processes are mostly affecting these smallest scales, but remaining the larger scales unchanged. So we can wonder now whether we can extract the information from astrophysics directly from these range temperature maps. So in order to do that, we can train a different convolutional neural network, which can be given, for instance, by the first part of the unit, the encoder, plus a multi-layer perceptron, so a fully connected layer, in order to perform regression of the astrophysical parameters, to infer these three astrophysical values. And these are the results for RESIC 15 and RESIC 10. So here we can see something that was pointed out before, that at RESIC 10, the astrophysical processes are more prominent, and therefore we can have a better inference of these astrophysical values.
The spread is just for different simulations. So you have all these different simulations.
Exactly. So these are for the testing data set. Okay. And for each of the points in the data sets, we have a prediction. And most of them lie very close to the true value. But mostly in this RESIC 10 case. Because here the astrophysical effects are more relevant. And when we had a worse accuracy for this case, for extracting the matter density field, for extracting the astrophysical parameters, we have here a better accuracy. So this is the contrast between these two networks. So you know that these neural networks are usually regarded as black boxes, and it's difficult sometimes to interpret what they are actually learning. So in order to gain insight into this, we can compute the so-called saliency maps, which are basically given by the gradient of the output with respect to the input image. So this is the absolute value of this gradient is giving us a map of where the brightest points are those which are more relevant for the neural network in order to predict the input. So as an example, so this is an image classification problem where for each image we have a saliency map. And we can see that this saliency map is remarking the, for instance, the edges of the image, or some patterns like the eyes of the animals, which are supposed to be the most relevant patterns to extract the label of these images. So we can apply this kind of method to our framework. So here are some brightness temperature maps, and the corresponding saliency map is superimposed. So this is for the CNN for astrophysical inference. So we are computing the gradient of the astrophysical parameters with respect to the input image. And here we can see that these red points are those points which are more relevant for the neural network to predict the given astrophysical parameters. So I would never expect that these regions will be, for instance, close to the overturned regions, these blue spots, which are where galaxies are placed. However, most of these points, the red points, are placed like relatively far away from the overturned regions and are sampling the intergalactic medium. So it is telling us that the neural network is actually looking at points far beyond from the galaxies to extract the astrophysical information. So sometimes this is a bit difficult to interpret, but well, it is a way to gain some insight into how these kind of neural networks can learn from data and the kind of patterns that they can extract from them.
Why is this?
Why
is it outside the overturned region the most important?
Yeah, that's something that is not clear to me. I mean, it's not trivial for me. Maybe because the X-rays, for instance, or for heating, have a large mean free path, and they are being deposited far from the sources. But it is something that is not trivial to interpret for me. But well, it's a way to understand what are they actually looking at in the image.
Is this the analysis where you're
marking
analyzing the astrophysical
parameters? So in this case, this is for the CNN, which is extracting the astrophysical parameters.
Oh, okay.
So because here is easier to extract the salience
image. And still is avoiding this overdense
region. Yes, in some way, yes. Okay. Any more questions? So then we can proceed to this second project that I want to introduce you. Which is based on a very recent paper, which has appeared today in the archive, and another companion paper, which will appear in the following days or to the next week. So, well, you know that galaxies in the universe are immersed in dark matter halos. And in these halos, so most of the matter is actually dark matter and therefore is non-visible, so we cannot observe it directly. But estimating the total mass of these halos is a crucial point in order to understand the halo galaxy connection, understand how baryons and dark matter are related and distributed. So for this reason, there are many methods which are devoted to weight galaxies, to weight dark matter halos, based, for instance, on the rotation curve of galaxies, which are just looking at the stars which are rotating around the center of the galaxy. And this is giving an idea of the matter which is within. Also, observing some kinematic tracers, such as globular clusters, which are orbiting around galaxies. And also the focusing on the relation between the stellar mass and the halo mass from numerical simulations and applied to real observations, which is the so-called abundance matching. So here in this project, our goal is to train a machine learning model, which is able to train it in simulations. And this machine learning model should be able to apply to real galaxies. And for instance, to apply to our own galaxy, the Milky Way or Andromeda, in order to weigh their dark matter halo. So in order to perform this task, we have made use of the so-called CAMEL simulations, which the name stands for Cosmology and Astrophysics with Machine Learning Simulations. So these are more than 4,000 state-of-the-art full hydrodynamical simulations, which are specially designed for training machine learning models, because they are covering a broad range of cosmological and astrophysical scenarios. So there is already some 2D maps and 3D grids, which are publicly available, the so-called CAMEL multi-field dataset. Well, the point here. Sure.
So you're saying these halos are difficult to estimate?
The mass of the halos.
The mass of the halos? It's because there is no visible anything around it, so we cannot, for example, look at rotation curves.
Yes, you only have access to some tracers, which
exactly.
Are, yes, but not to the full distribution of that.
And in general, knowing better this mass of halos, what kind of things would impact?
So, for instance, to understand well how baryonic physics, so baryonic matter and dark matter are related, so the relative between both, mm-hmm. or for instance, to understand the effect of astrophysical field effects. Okay. Because if you compare the stellar mass of the halo versus the total mass of the halo, so depending on the mass, you have a different ratio between both quantities. And this depends on the astrophysical effects which are happening, for instance. So understanding all of this halo galaxy connection is a way to understand either astrophysics or the more cosmological ideas. So for the reason we use these CAMEL simulations, which are these are containing two different simulation sets, the so-called Illustris TNG and SIGMA. So here the main difference are that they rely on different numerical codes and numerical techniques in order to solve hydrodynamics. But the key difference is that they employ different subgrid physics models. So this is just the way that they implement astrophysical effects at scales smaller than those that they can reach in simulations. So there are some processes such as the growth of black holes or the feedback from EGMs, which are expected to happen at scales smaller than those that you can properly simulate. And therefore you have to implement them, implement these effects in a phenomenological way. And it is not clear which is the best way to do that. And for this reason, there are these two different models to perform this astrophysical feedback prescription. So as an example, these are different fields from these different simulation suites. And here we can see that when the dark matter density is mostly the same for both phases, you can see that the gas density and the gas temperature can be completely different, depending on which of these subgrid physics models we are employing. So these Kammel simulations also take into account six different free parameters, because here the idea is to train machine learning models over different cosmological scenarios and astrophysical scenarios. So they vary six different parameters, two of them which are cosmological, the omega matter and sigma A. So this is basically the amount of matter in the universe and the variance of the perturbations. And also four of them which are accounting for astrophysical effects, two of them for the effect of supernova in galaxies, which can release matter and energy into the medium, and also for the AGN field, active galactic nuclei field, which are basically these supermassive black holes which are injecting energy through these jets. So,
the cameras is like a wrapping library for either ILOS or SIGMA?
So,
or it does anything else beyond the.
So the point is that there are some original simulations called Illustris Tengi and Simba,
yeah,
which were like, for Illustris Tengi, I think that there are three simulations. So here these camels are using these models that are employed there,
okay,
the subgrid physics models and the numerical techniques, to solve similar simulations, but in a small box, but varying these cosmological and astrophysical parameters. So in that case, we have more than 4,000 simulations, rather than just three, because we are sampling over different models. So this is the main idea behind Kammel. So our point is that we extract, therefore, halos, dark matter halos from these simulations. And we want to predict the mass of a given halo given some of the properties of its hosted galaxies. So these features could be, for instance, the 3D position, the velocity, the stellar mass, or the stellar radius. So we are only focusing on observable quantities because we want to apply these kind of models to real data.
So you use all galaxies as fine.
Yes. So these simulations can resolve the shape of the galaxies, actually. And they actually can go down to 10 to the 8 solar masses, which is a quite good resolution.
10 to the what?
10 to the 8 solar masses.
Ah, the resolution?
Yes.
Yeah.
The mass resolution of the galaxies.
Yeah, because the mass of the actual galaxies are much larger, like 10 to the 13 or so.
Yes, the typical galaxies are larger, like 10 to the 12, for instance, for the Milky Way.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
But the smallest galaxies that these simulations can resolve are like that. So these are not dwarf galaxies, but these can be, for instance, satellites of the Milky Way. They can have these kind of masses, like 10 to the 8. So the key idea in our framework is that we regard each of these halos as a mathematical graph. So a graph is just a mathematical structure where we have a collection of nodes, and we connect these nodes by edges. So in our case, we have a halo is given as a graph, where each of the nodes is a galaxy with a feature vector, with the position, velocity, etc. And each of these nodes is connected by an edge, depending on the relative distance between the galaxies. So with this framework, we can then apply the so-called graph neural networks to extract the mass of the halo.
Several galaxies.
Yes, so a typical halo has a big central galaxy plus some satellite galaxies around. For instance, in the case of the Milky Way, we have the Milky Way, which is the central galaxy, and the Magellanic Clouds, for instance, which are the largest satellite galaxies. Or for Andromeda, we have Andromeda and the Triangulum Galaxy. So typical halos have subhalos, and these subhalos, the most massive subhalos, can host other galaxies.
How do you define that?
How do you define
the size and the, I mean, the center of the halo? I mean, it's
so in simulation,
fixed is,
in simulation, it is the so-called friend of friends algorithm, which is identifying like the regions which are bounded gravitationally. And yes, the largest galaxy there is assigned to be the central head, or the central subhead on the central galaxy. Okay, so as I said, we can apply to these graphs, we can apply the so-called graph neural networks. But why graph neural networks? Why should we care about this architecture? So well, the point is that the type of neural network that we employ in our data should depend on the structure of the data that we are dealing with. So for instance, a convolutional neural network works pretty well with 2D images, with pictures, or with 3D grids. So in general, with any kind of data, whose units are structured in a regular grid, for instance, the pixels in an image. On the other hand, a recurrent neural network is specially designed for treating sequential data, for instance, to text processing or to deal with time series. So in all data where the units are sequentially ordered. In contrast, a graph neural network is especially suited for trading with irregular data, where one can have arbitrary connections between the different units. So for instance, this is the case of a molecule in chemistry, a mesh in a 3D volume, or for instance, a social network. So these are examples of graphs that you can find, but also a cloud of points, which is our case, which is a distribution of points in the real space where you can place edges depending on the distance. And for instance, in this case, this has been already applied, this kind of GNNs in particle physics, as shown in this paper, where they discuss different applications on jet classification, event classification, or tracking of charged particles, for instance. So the key idea in these three different types of neural networks is that they enforce in some way locality. What means that given a pixel, for instance, in an image, its neighbors should influence more this pixel than other pixels which are further away. So in a graph neural network, it happens the same. So even a node, its neighbors, local neighbors, should have a larger impact in the physics of this node than those which are further away.
Yeah. I mean, about the CNNs, mm-hmm. There are no studies, similar studies to CNNs.
Regarding what?
The same. Instead of GNNs, using CNNs.
But for, you mean for these halos? Yes, there are studies also, but in that case you have to treat data as images, for instance, yes. Or theories.
Sure, but I mean, is there much of a gain, CNNs versus GNNs in this case?
The point of using CNNs is that you have a grid, and therefore you have to imagine that your galaxies are very close one from another, and then you need a very fine grid in order to represent these galaxies which are apart from each other. The point of a GNN is that it can deal better with sparse data, where you don't have a regular grid. So for this kind of things, GNN will be better.
You mean that you will need a finer granularity in CNN, which will make that exactly. It will not work that well.
Exactly, you need more resolution, and this is more time consuming, and you need more resources.
No, but also the fact that in GNNs you exploit the connection between the points.
Yes.
Yeah, but I mean,
you are not exploring in the same way.
You are doing exactly.
That depends on what you want. If you want an average or a map, in the end, I mean, it mostly work. The only thing is if the resolution is not good enough to use.
Yes, it could work, but depends on the final task. Yeah. For instance, in our case, we get a global quantity of the halo, and for this reason, it seems to be more appropriate to use these GNNs,
yeah, I don't know. I mean, maybe you know more than myself about GNNs. But if you have a CNN with a very fine granularity, mm-hmm. it is not yet enough to do the same things that GNNs are doing.
Right? Exactly.
So GNNs are doing much more than.
Yes, depending on the data.
Depending
on the data, it could do more.
Depending on the relations between the two vertices. Mm-hmm. These edges may be described by many features, right?
Yes, in our cases, we are taking
into
account the distances.
The generic statement may be that GNNs are really exploiting.
Exactly, they are exploiting the relations.
Much more efficiently, the relationship between the.
Can be arbitrary. Yeah. In a CNN, you have a regular grid.
Yeah.
But in a GNN, you have arbitrary connections between the different units. And in that way, you can exploit these properties in a more powerful way, I would say. So just to better understand how this GNN works, we can discuss their symmetries. So for instance, consider a convolutional neural network, which is aimed to classify an image. So for instance, we have an image of a cat, and we want a CNN to predict the label of this image. So the point is that if we perform a arbitrary translation of the object within the picture, the CNN should be able to still predict the same output of the of the image, because the location of the cat within the picture shouldn't impact the final result, because the label is the same, it's still the same. So this is the so-called translational invariant. analogously, a GNN is so-called permutation invariant. So imagine that we have a graph in a graph, which is, for instance, describing a halo, and we join a GNN to predict the mass of the halo. So we can order in an array all the feature vectors of each node, which each of them are including the position, the velocity, and the stellar mass, for instance. The point is that if we perform an arbitrary permutation of the nodes, and therefore we change the ordering for computations, so we change the ordering in this array, the output of the GNN should be the same than before. And this is because GNNs have to fulfill permutation invariants. You can see that these both symmetries can be represented symbolically in this way. And this is just because the neural networks are predicting a global quantity of the full graph. The mass of the halo should depend on the order of the computations, in the same way that the labels should depend on where the cap is located in the picture. And we can fulfill these permutation invariants just by construction. So this is the so-called message passing scheme or neighborhood aggregation scheme. So this is how a generic graph neural network works. So, so this works as follows. So imagine that we have a graph. We take a node, and for each of the neighbors of this node, we compute the, we concatenate the feature vectors. So each of these feature vectors is including the properties of the galaxies. And we pass them through a multilayer perceptron, so a standard fully connected neural network. Performing that for each of the neighbors, we can then aggregate the outputs to produce a hidden representation of this original node. And this aggregation step is just an arbitrary permutation invariant operation, such as the sum, the maximum, or the mean. But it's the way to ensure that this graph neural network has to be permutation invariant. So we can perform this for each of the nodes in the graph to obtain a hidden representation of the full graph, where each of these hidden layers is encoding information about the neighborhood of the original node. So at the end, since we want a global quantity of the halo, we have to, again, aggregate over these hidden layers. We can pass it through another multilayer perceptron to predict a global quantity, which in our case is the mass of the halo. So this is basically how generic GNN works. And there are many different architectures which are specific cases of this, but this is like the most general way to view it. So actually, rather to infer only the mass of the halo, we want also to have an estimate of the expected uncertainty of the prediction. Therefore, we can achieve that by predicting two different quantities, the mean and the standard deviation of the mass of the halo, or actually the logarithm of the mass of the halo. So in that way, we are, in some sense, sampling the posterior distribution, but without really knowing the likelihood of the data. So for this reason, this is so-called likelihood-free inference. And we can obtain that just by modifying the loss function. So we have this standard loss function term, which is basically given by the minimum square error of the prediction minus the true value of the mass of the halo. But then we append an additional contribution of the loss function, which is enforcing, when it is minimized, it is enforcing to approach this sigma to the real standard deviation of the data. And therefore, we are minimizing these both contributions on the same. So note here that if we write the chi-square in a standard way, so minimizing the L2 term implies that this chi-square should be close to 1. So therefore, we can use this chi-square as a way to check the accuracy of the network at predicting the uncertainties. If this chi-square is close to 1, we can say that the standard deviations are properly sampled.
Sorry, just one question. Yes. Yeah, I mean, you are, in any case, this is equivalent to assuming that you have a Gaussian distribution, so it is not likelihood free. Right, so
I don't see why it is assuming a Gaussian distribution. I think that it,
I think what I'm saying is that if you assume a Gaussian distribution in which every point has its own variance,
mm-hmm.
the training that you're doing is exactly using this cost function. So at the end of the day, these guys, what you're doing here, is just equivalent to assume that you have a Gaussian distribution.
But in principle, it shouldn't be Gaussianly distributed.
It shouldn't, but you are assuming, in practice, a shape for the likelihood. So I am confused about the fact that you name it like the space. So it's a bit.
But I think that this is extracting the mean and the standard deviation of the posterior, but not, it is not assuming the shape of the house.
So
we have trained this GNN on these illustrious TNG simulations in camels. So this is one of the two simulation suites. And these are two different cases where we have trained the GNN. So this is the prediction and the truth versus the true value of the mass of the halo. So in this left panel, we are training only in simulations where the cosmological and astrophysical parameters are kept fixed. So this is some sort of fiducial model, the so-called CV case. And here we can see that in this case, the accuracy is pretty good. And most of the points are pretty close to the true values of the mass. So this can be seen from the relative error, for instance, which is lower than 1%. So this is the relative error of the logarithms of the mass, not the relative error of the mass, which is mid-larger. But so this is accurate, but this is a simplistic case because we are keeping fixed all the astrophysical information. And we actually want a model which is able to parallelize over it. So to obtain that, we have trained the GNNs in 1,000 simulations varying cosmological and astrophysical parameters. We can see here that while the accuracy slightly gets worse, we still are able to predict accurately the mass of the halo, but now with larger error bars because now we have an additional centrality from covering cosmological and astrophysical models, and therefore our predictions are less precise. So,
in this y-axis, the point 4 doesn't mean 40%.
So here, this y-axis, these are the difference between the logarithm of the prediction and the truth. So for the reason, 0.2 is like 0.2 orders of magnitude in the mass. So in astrophysics, it is so-called 0.2 vex. Oh. Is the way that people in astrophysics usually call this measure. So for instance, 1 is the part of an order of magnitude. Is in the prediction of the real mass.
I was confused because the epsilon is 1.3%. It looks like it's a good fit.
Yes.
You're doing very well, but looking at the y-axis, one would say that you are not doing that well.
So this is the mean relative error of the logarithms of the masses. So not on the masses, because you compute the relative error on the masses is large. Mm-hmm. Actually, it is think that it can be up to 60% or so when you have 0.2 orders of magnitude. But this is like and other methods in the literature aiming to do this task are like having larger scale, and are less precise. For instance, using machine learning methods or traditional methods.
You are talking about 1,000 simulations. I mean,
yes, in the red case, yes.
Yeah, I mean, I don't get a feeling for this one if that's a lot or not. I mean.
So note that here we are varying six parameters, two cosmological and four astrophysical. And then we are sampling 1,000 simulations, the so-called lighting hypercube. So each of the simulations has a different choice of astrophysical parameters and cosmological parameters.
Yeah, what I mean is that enough?
Yes, we think that is enough for sampling. And basically because this way of sampling, this lighting hypercube, if we made a regular grid, for instance, probably it wouldn't be enough. In this way, we are sampling the parameter space in a more appropriate way to cover the possible models.
You understand why the dispersion
is bigger and larger than low mass? Yes, so the point is that at large masses, we have less samples in the simulations because there are less galaxies which are so large, like with 10 to the 14 solar masses. And for lower masses, so the point is that we are limiting only to halos which have at least the central galaxy and a satellite galaxy, because the GNNs work better in this case. So we are excluding those halos which have only one galaxy. And most of the halos in this range of masses have only one galaxy. So for this reason, at these two ranges, the accuracy is really the two ones.
Wrapping up, like in 5 minutes.
Well, they
Yeah, because there is another book.
Okay. Yeah, so maybe I can skip some things. Yeah, let me explain pretty fast these saliency graphs. So we can analogously to computing the saliency maps in a CNN, we can compute the so-called saliency graph, which is basically given by the gradient of the output with respect to the input nodes. Therefore, those galaxies which has will have a larger saliency value will be more relevant in order to predict the output. So this top row stands for saliency graphs in the case where we can fix the cosmological and astrophysical parameters. So in this case, we can see that the GNN is mostly looking at the central galaxy, which is usually the largest galaxy. So the size represents the stellar mass. So in most of these cases, the central galaxy is the most massive one. And the GNN is extracting most of the information to predict the mass of the halo from the central galaxy. However, when we train the GNN in varying astrophysics and cosmology, so these are saliency graphs for this case. And here we can see that the most relevant galaxies are some smaller satellites, which are, for instance, these satellites which are farther away from the central galaxy. And this was very surprising to me because it is telling us that the GNN is actually looking at other features. For instance, it is looking at the velocity of a smaller satellite or the size of the halo or the morphology in some ways, rather than focusing on the central galaxy, which naively one could expect that would be the most relevant one for this task. So it illustrates how a neural network can learn different features in order to perform a task, depending on the data set. So since we have a robust model based on GNNs trained in simulations, then we want to apply it to real data to infer the mass of real halos, for instance, the halos of the Milky Way and the halo of Andromeda. So for doing that, we have to consider, in each case, those satellite galaxies, which are massive enough, about the mass resolution of Campbell simulations, which is 10 to the 8 solar masses. So for the Milky Way, we have the central galaxy, which is the Milky Way itself, plus these two Magellanic clouds, the large and small Magellanic clouds, which are the largest satellites of the Milky Way halo. And for the Andromeda case, we have the Andromeda, which is also called M51, the Triangulum galaxy, which is the third largest galaxy in the local group, and also these two other smaller satellite galaxies. So for each of them, we consider some observable features, such as the position, the 3D position, the modulus of the velocity, and the stellar mass in each case. So to check how similar are these galaxies to the Campbell's simulated galaxies. So this is a plot of the velocity versus the stellar mass. For the Campbell simulations, also for these satellite galaxies. And here we can notice that this large Magellanic cloud, this satellite of the Milky Way, is somewhat too fast compared to its equivalent galaxies in the Campbell simulations. And this has an impact in results, as we shall see in the next slides. So then we can therefore employ these GNNs to infer the mass of Andromeda, for instance. So here there are different typical estimates for inferring the mass of Andromeda using, for instance, the motion of the stellar streams or the dynamics of the local group or the phenomenology and photometry of satellite galaxies. So in most of them, they provide estimations between 1 and 2 times 10 to the 12 solar masses for the mass of the Andromeda halo. So we have trained 4 different GNN models, depending on whether we employ Illustris TNG or Simba, so the simulation suite in Campbell's, on whether we employ velocities or not to train the neural network. And we can see that in these 4 cases, these black points, so most of the standard estimations are consistent with your predictions within 1 or 2 sigma, so within the 1 or 2 sigma confidence range. So this is a pretty good match with standard estimations. And also note that when we employ velocities in these 2 cases, the error bars that we expect are smaller. And this is just because we are employing more information from the galaxies. And this is providing us a better estimate, a more precise estimate. So we can perform the same task for the Milky Way, where here we have many more estimates of the Milky Way mass. Most of them are providing an estimate around 10 to the 12 solar masses. So we then apply our 4 GNN models. And we can see that when we only employ positions and stellar masses, so excluding velocity, our predictions are very consistent with most of the standard estimates within one sigma region, which is a very good match. But so we can see that when we employ velocities, there is some sort of overestimation of the mass of the Milky Way, a factor of 2, roughly. And this is just because something that I said before, that the Large Magellanic Cloud seems to be too fast compared to standard galaxies. And this is enforcing in some way that the GNN is predicting a larger value of the mass. And this is actually something which was already present in literature. People have tried to estimate the mass of the Milky Way using the velocity of the Large Magellanic Cloud, for instance, in this work, and they found a larger value of the mass. So this is something consistent also with literature. And it is also pointing out to another fact, which is that the Milky Way halo may not be a usual halo or a usual galaxy, regarding some properties where the Milky Way departs from the typical trend in galaxy population. For instance, the satellite population of the Milky Way, or the relation between the luminosity and the rotational velocity, which is the so-called Tully-Fisher relation. So in these points, the Milky Way seems to be a bit non-usual galaxy. Well, basically, that's all that I wanted to comment. So we have seen that machine learning methods can be applied to cosmology and astrophysics to maximize the information that we can extract. For instance, we can extract the matter density field from a given Einstein temperature map using convolutional neural networks. And also, a GNN is able to learn the connection between halos and galaxies to extract the mass of the halo. And in both cases, we can marginalize over astrophysical content to extract more cosmological fundamental information. And also, in this case, we can apply these kind of models to real data to infer the mass of the Milky Way and Andromeda, which is, to my knowledge, the first time that artificial intelligence has been employed for doing it. And that's all. And thank you.
Thanks a lot for the interesting talk. So, is there any questions for you in the audience?
Any questions? Pablo, in principle, use these GNNs to extract the energy density profile or the distribution of dark matter, looking at other types of simulations, I guess.
So, you mean in a halo or in a bigger simulation? Yes, I mean, in principle, you could extract anything that you want, for instance, a global quantity of the full halo, or also as property from the nodes.
You're talking about the profile?
Yes.
It will be regarded as a global feature of the full halo, so you could extract that. In that case, you have an array of numbers, right? Rather than a single number.
But with yours also?
Yes, in principle, yes. So you can train a GNN in the same way, but you have to change the output that you are predicting.
So
yes.
There are people doing that with GNNs.
Yeah, but with GNNs,
I'm not aware of
it. In that way, you could exploit the sparse distribution of data. For instance, because if you are looking, in that case, to galaxies or to stars.
Even, right? If you look at the Gaia data.
Yes, yes. True. So that will be a powerful, yes. Overall application for doing that.
Maybe someone in Zoom wants to ask a question. Please. And if not, you know, Pablo, you are downstairs, where is your office?
Yes, B1-0.
Sorry, so any further questions you got?
Sure. You mean for the results? So, I mean, in these cases, we have boxes of 25 megaparsecs. So, there will have many halos with it. So, you have a large enough simulation. Yeah, the box wouldn't be. The mass resolution is for these galaxies.
I mean, when you quantify the impact, the mass resolution, if you go to instead of 10 to 8, for that is the limit you have.
Yes.
But you can see.
We have said that for the inference of the Milky Way and Andromeda by removing some of these satellites, and there is actually an impact in the result. So if we just remove some of these satellites and train the network or predict the result from the network, there is some sort of overestimation of the mass, which means that the satellite galaxies are actually meaningful and important for the prediction. So maybe this is a way to quantify how this depends.
And And then you have a simulation. So then you have a simulation where you have Milky Way and Andromeda, because the results that we're getting them with new velocities, and you were pointing out that they are very massive in those cases. But you know, you have a constraint from the velocity that Andromeda approaches us, which is the sum of the two galaxies, which is much smaller than the sum that you get from it. So probably you have simulation with the two galaxies, it would actually reduce and move everything to the left, which is what you would expect.
Yeah, that's a good point, but we are just considering the halo of Andromeda and the halo of the Milky Way as independent. But in reality, these halos are on the gravitational. They are approaching each other. And this will be an impact.
That was actually one of the implications of dark matter, which was much earlier than the rotation galaxies, the velocity converging of Andromeda.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
And the sum is much more, I mean, it's already that is
the sum. These kind of estimates are based on the dynamics of the local group, which are these estimates. But depending on how do you do that, you can have like larger values for both masses or lower.
Yeah, but that's putting both together.
Yes, yes.
The limit on the sum of the masses is already at the level of the mass you are getting for
the. But that's a very good point that we are just regarding these halos as independent, but they are also interacting, and therefore it has an impact.
Now I got confused. How was this error budget?
Over error bars, you mean? Yeah. So from the GNN prediction, we are predicting a mean and unexpected uncertainty of the mass of the halo.
Ah, yeah, yeah.
With this
other thing that
yes.
Okay.
Yes. So it is some sort of intrinsic standard deviation from the GNN.
Yeah, yeah.
Plus other uncertainties that you can have from the velocity of the satellite galaxies, for instance, which are not included here.
So you said that there is this simulation of translation relations.
Yes.
And in order to do that, you would like to select first a central point and then a wireless point.
Yes.
You can shoot the needle. Does it have an effect which points to choose on the size of the needle?
So it has an effect. So basically, you take each of the nodes, maybe one after the other, and you compute the neighborhood for each of them. And as you say, so how we construct this neighborhood, so we just are taking those halos, those galaxies which are closer, so below a certain distance, are taken as a range. In principle, this is a free parameter, no friend. So this minimum distance to consider a neighborhood. And we are optimizing this parameter. We have found that this can be actually large enough to construct, so each of these halos are basically a complete graph, which most of the nodes are connected. Which makes some sense because gravitation is at the end a long range interaction. And therefore, all the patches will be affected. Not all of them, but many of them.
Very good.
Thank you. Hello?
Yeah.
Well, I'm
kind of curious about the units. You mentioned a lot of people, well, but you can also comment on the office. Well, but could you comment on what kind of loss function do you use there, or how do you regularize that?
So this is the loss function, a minimum square. Well, the output is just the map of the institution. Yeah. But we are regularizing using the two regularization. But this is just to power the machine.
Okay, so
this is just stuff.
Questions? So, really, thank you again, Pablo, for this interesting topic.
I'm very delighted. Thank you.